everybody, welcome to Roundtable Live, a show about video games on the internet. I'm Bear Taffy, joined by my esteemed, gracious, and lovely co-hosts, Rock Lee Smile, Mathis Games, and Northern Line. How you guys doing?
Three seconds in, somebody says shit.
Why did Mathis say shit?
I just was caught off guard.
No,
you knew this was coming eventually.
We've done 42 episodes of this show. At least like half of those have been live. You know the drill by now, don't you?
There's probably more than half have been live now, probably.
Yeah, maybe. I can't keep track of time anymore.
I went to, yeah, like Chad said, sorry, I was at a matinee.
Oh, that's right.
Were you really?
Meant to, no, it was not.
See. It's just a safe assumption, though, at this point for you. on the docket today, it's a good show, albeit starting off on a little bit of a sad note. The Disney Infinity cancellation looms over the week, unfortunately, for a lot of people. That entire studio actually being closed down as well, unfortunately, so there's a big story. Civ 6, however, was announced, so good news there for folks who are fans of that franchise, myself included. The WESA has been formed today, actually. Breaking news today, the World Esports Association was just put together. So really big scoop there as well. And I,
we's are gonna play some esports.
You got it before me, man. I was gonna go the Jar Jar route.
Sorry, I couldn't help it.
It was like that was the first thing I thought of. I just got the image of Jar Jar Binks emblazoned onto my brain as soon as I saw that abbreviation. And then a few games in the docket here as well. We got Tasty Lethal Tactics, Blockhood, and Stellaris to talk about as well. Starting off, though, as I mentioned on that sad, sad note, a Disney Infinity cancellation, which did not really, or was not really expected, I'd say, by a lot of people, given the nature of how successful the Toys to Life genre has really been recently. But all the same, Disney Infinity...
Hold on. You can't just drop a phrase like Toys to Life.
No, it's
as
real.
As if we all operate in the toy peripheral industry.
I've never heard that phrase used.
The first time I've ever heard of that.
I thought you guys all were running those secondary toy channels, man. Those are the big market right now. You got the prank channels, gaming, and then like toys is right there.
I don't want to be successful. Are you silly? What are you doing over there? Why would I do that?
Why would you be on this show if you wanted that? That's ridiculous.
Exactly.
Toys to Life, it's a thing.
Yeah, Toys to Life is a genre. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What is Toys to Life
it's
mean?
Stuff like Skylanders, Disney Infinity, where you take a toy, you put it on a little pedestal, and it comes to life in your video game, and you play with that.
Yeah. More or less. That really describes the genre, yes. But Disney Infinity is, you know, was, I guess I should say now, one of those key contributors in the Toys to Life genre. And now no more. Announcing the cancellation on Tuesday was the studio citing poor performance from Disney Infinity 3.0, the release there. I guess they prepared for a lot more than was received as far as the inventory of actual figures goes. So they had some big plans here as well, unfortunately. It sounds like they had plans to release some much more detailed, like 12-inch figures of certain characters, which would have been pretty neat.
Damage.
Yeah. So just unfortunate here, I guess. But it is also, like, you find it shocking, right? Mathis, I imagine someone who's at least got, you know, like a passing interest in the Toys to Life genre, now that we've coined it.
Yeah, I have some. I have, like, I don't know, 7 maybe Disney Infinity figures. I think mostly Star Wars, with the exception of, like, one Marvel character. Mm. But I have them for collection. I played with them a little bit, but the Disney Infinity, like, game itself doesn't really, it's not really my thing. However, the toy box mode, which is probably the most popular mode, is really well done. Like, Disney Infinity is a fun game. But I think Disney Infinity kind of, I don't want to say flopped because it's been around for a while, is that there were 3 iterations of it, of which, like, Disney Infinity 1 and 2.0 cannot use Disney Infinity 3.0 figures, and you have to always buy the new bundle, which is like $100 to $150, and the play sets that go with the older ones don't work on the newer ones. Mm-hmm. So you kind of keep shaving out your audience every single time, and I don't know if I read or heard rumor that there was plans of a 4.0 at some point, which I think would have been really dumb.
You know what they're changing from iteration to iteration? Is it just the hardware, or?
I don't know. I'm not so into it that I'm not entirely sure.
You know more than I do already.
The figures themselves look slightly different. Like, the newer ones are much more detailed. I just like the figures of the 3.0 stuff because they just look good. The molds are nice. Mm-hmm. They're pretty high quality. But I don't really, I mean, the need to constantly upgrade feels like you're just constantly cutting out more and more and more of your audience.
Yeah. The game itself, I mean, like you said, they had quite a few things that really sort of steered people away, you know? Like, I think a lot of the appeal to Disney Infinity was that sort of Kingdom Hearts universe crossover stuff where you get, say, like, you get to take Chip and Dale into the world of Frozen or whatever the hell you want to do, you know? Like, that's the freedom people
it
wanted to explore.
The world of Frozen.
Yeah. Of all of the possible crossovers, Chip and Dale into the world of Frozen.
Doesn't
not
that
like
make
Iron
sense?
Man into Star Wars.
I think it makes perfect sense.
Yeah, but no, they would be adorable companions there. At least
I want to put the Little Mermaid in Aladdin's Agrabah.
Yeah.
No, I want to put Iron Man and Captain America on the Death Star, and I want them to fight against Rohan the Destroyer.
Sure.
I forget the guy's name from Guardians of the Galaxy.
Were they the ones that had Portal and Doctor Who also, or was that another?
That's the Lego.
Figuring?
Yeah.
Okay, the Lego. Okay, so what's the current hierarchy right now? So is it Amiibos and then
Skylanders?
Skylanders
has got to be up there somewhere, right?
I think is still sitting properly up at number one.
Really?
Like they're doing the most. I think so.
Really?
Well, Disney Infinity very well might have been on top, honestly, which is the most shocking part of this, I think. I think they may have been the number one player, and now they're gone.
They had market share, and they still didn't do enough. They did like a Square Enix, where it's like, you did really good, but it wasn't good enough for yourself.
Yeah, more or less. It's starting to sound like that the more I read into it. Like, they had grand plans. It didn't sound like a studio that had any intention or idea that they were going to be going away anytime soon. You know, like the entirety of Avalanche, they had like a at least a 1 year breakdown of plans for the near future here with stuff they wanted to release. So it just seems like Disney, I guess their bar is set pretty damn high here. You know, like with Infinity, the initial launch too. I know that Disney as a video game company, you know, like that subset of Disney, had been in quite a hole for some time there, like probably between the years of like 2008 and when did Skylanders really start to get big?
2010, I think.
Was it a while ago?
Yeah, so like through that entire time, Disney was suffering, you know, like they were losing tons of money through that period. So I think with Infinity, they got a little bit of a resurgence, but then it just didn't end up being enough despite that huge success that was the start of it.
I got a way they could come back into it. Disney Infinity Ward. And then they make Call of Duty figurines that bring in perks to your multiplayer action.
Oh,
and
shit.
You buy those.
I like
you
that.
You buy them.
Mm-hmm.
It's perks.
The whole of it is shocking to me, though, just considering all
they
those
have some
different
like
factors.
Real knockout, like they have Star Wars and Marvel, like that's some huge like potential. They are as well as like obviously classic Disney characters and all their other Pixar Disney movies, which are pretty big. But I feel like Disney Infinity 3.0 is what got me to start collecting, you know, certain figurines. It's not like my Amiibo obsession, but it was nice enough where I was like, I love Star Wars, I want to have these figurines because they're well done. It's surprising that they ended up closing down, especially since I think they were still profitable, but they just maybe were not as profitable as they were projecting to be, I guess. I mean, I'm not completely caught up on the story as to why they had to shut down, but I know I'm pretty sure they weren't losing money.
What it sounded like was the big kicker, or at least one of the big kickers, was they anticipated way more sales than they ended up getting, so they built way more inventory in stock than they could sell. So they've just got like such a loss for their actual physical products that I guess. Really, the Infinity sales didn't do a lot to cancel that out. Not to mention the fact that I'm sure a lot, if not like almost all of the hype surrounding new Infinity characters was probably centralized around Star Wars, right? I imagine that's got to be like the grand majority of what people are buying into.
Star Wars in Marvel.
Yeah.
And then like, you think they're super pissed at like that BB-8 $100 toy came out around the same time? They're like, I love this BB-8.
Right.
BB-8's so cute, we could have sold we could have kept the company afloat, but instead you had to do your own thing.
I'm surprised BB-8 didn't get an Infinity figure.
Yeah, that is interesting too.
It's all fucking politics.
It is.
Like,
I'm
the BB-8 thing was a big deal because you could have this little remote control gyroscopic ball and you could control it from your iPhone, right? So why couldn't they set it up so like the NFC thing was in your iPhone And then you could buy like a whole range of different things that could all be Disney Infinity. And sure. then you could like morph away from it just being the same statues, and they could have a variety of things. Maybe yeah. that would have helped.
Yeah, well,
just in general, you're really like poking the cosmic bear when you name your product Infinity. Mm. It's like you're just daring yeah. to close you down.
This is no. This is the third Infinity.
Right, the first Disney Infinity 3.0,
yeah. When does it become Disney Infinity Infinite 0.0, right? Like, the loop just continues right. on. You can't just keep adding patches after patches.
I mean, outside of the fact that they've also kind of, like, cut their own consumer base by re-releasing it two or three times, by the third time you've released it, you also have, like, all the Skylanders that people have bought, all the Amiibos that people have bought into, all the now the Lego Dimensions one that people have bought into. At least with Amiibos, like, you don't have to buy into like $100 or $150 base set. You just buy the figurines and it goes onto your controller and it works.
Yeah.
There is no set that you have to like scan your Amiibo over. But all these other ones are like the Lego one, the Dimensions, you have to buy the base set that works, the portal and all that stuff, which is 100 or more. So by the time 3.0 came out, there was already like more happening, and then Dimensions was coming out. It's just like, all right, there may be an oversaturation of the Toys to Life market at this point.
Yeah,
I think it's a little bit of arrogance to assume that they can get away with just using their name to try and sell this extra peripheral that isn't really even necessary, because they could have used other technology that already exists and not had to do that at all. What's going on with Ryan?
Like, I'm trying to adjust my webcam here. Like, is it working? Not really. It's this, like, I have this light above me, so it makes it look like I'm a freaking ghost or something, but, like, I go,
all right, right now.
Oh, there you go.
Damn, all right, that's a new look.
The interesting thing, I think, that comes out of this, though, is now that opens the opportunity for Disney to license out Marvel and Star Wars to other Toys to Life companies, if they so choose, Lego Dimensions, where there's already a Lego Star Wars and Lego Marvel characters. And now they can license it out to, if they choose, to Lego Dimensions, which could keep make Lego Dimensions much more profitable and maybe make Disney more profitable in the process. Like, that's, I feel like that's such an easy transition to move Star Wars characters and Marvel characters to the Lego, because they already exist in the Lego world, to the Lego's Toys to Life world, since it really wouldn't work with Skylanders. I mean, Skylanders recently did, and I say recent, within the past 6 months, did a crossover promotion with Amiibo where they had Bowser Skylander and Donkey Kong Skylanders. So, I mean, it's not out of the question to see them cross over and do something else. So that could, I mean, we could see that happen.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I think the continued success of Disney certainly isn't a question we're really concerned about, right?
Well, their movie world is keeping them very rich.
Right.
They seem to be doing okay.
But, you know, as far as their video game presence goes, it looks like they're probably starting to just sort of see the writing on the wall. You know, yeah, they're go ahead and duck out of that, I guess. But I sort of want to get back to like what actually made Disney Infinity, or what made it so people weren't really drawn to Disney Infinity. I think we touched on a lot with the fact that there wasn't a lot of crossover for characters. Like, the universes were really sort of compacted into just these short little experiences that, while they probably were good, they weren't really what people were looking for, I think, in this old framework. Because this is a platform ahead of it being a game, right? Like, as far as the actual Disney Infinity game goes, it's just sort of like a platform for other experiences to take place on, not necessarily like a package that you want to sell independently to people.
Yeah, I don't know. I feel like I'm trying to think, like, what do the others offer that Disney Infinity didn't? And there's really nothing that I can honestly think of. Because you have the ability, like, in Skylanders, the same thing in Disney Infinity, like, each one of your characters and toys has, like, a skill tree that you level up, and it gets saved on the toy, and it's like a Diablo-esque kind of leveling system. There's special loot drops. You have the play sets that you go in and you play through the story of each play set, unlock other characters, unlock other power-ups and stuff. The real draw for Infinity that I feel like it had that leg up on other ones was that toy box mode, where you could create your own levels, share those levels with other people.
Right.
It was really kind of an all-ages thing. And I know I read a lot of stories where parents played with their kids and built levels together and had a good time. Like, there was that aspect.
Like a Little Big Planet style thing, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep, very much like a Little Big Planet style thing. And you could make this Star Wars-themed world and have fucking Iron Man flying around it and, like, playing around and having a lot of good times with it. I thought it was great. I thought it was a really good concept and a lot of fun, but did not.
Well,
work out.
Didn't pick up. As somebody on the outside, and I know very little about the community of this or even really the immediate details of what the games entailed, but from the outside perspective, I feel like the only real thing that any of these sets have to offer is whatever they can leverage off their own properties. So Disney being the largest of all of them, as it is, it feels like they had the most potential. So for them to bow out, well, like you said, it opens up the option for licensing, which actually might end up being better for everyone the long run.
I feel like Lego has a good move. Mm-hmm. Lego has probably the widest breadth of licenses because of all the movie deals that they've had. I mean, you look at what Lego Dimensions has out right now for like play sets. You have Simpsons, Portal, Lord of the Rings, Back to the Future, Doctor Who, like all Ghostbusters, like all these are playsets you can buy right now, and they're like $30, and you get two characters, the level, and like some other things.
Is that all it is?
Yeah, it's a playset.
They price really, really highly for anything licensed in general.
Yeah, I mean, like, the levels themselves are I think anywhere between like, I think they're around like 3 or 4 hours of content built into it, plus the characters that come with their own abilities and stuff. They have Batman already that came with the base set, all kinds of stuff. So I feel like Lego has a pretty big thing to draw from.
Yeah.
But I don't know how Lego is doing.
As far as their... Well, the video game set of Lego is doing remarkably well, I think, actually. Mm-hmm. Like, I know the Lego Star Wars games did well. The Lego... just about every franchise Lego game that's come out has done pretty damn well, I think. I also like that we're creating sort of this, like... noble cause that Disney has come forth with of, you know, we're not doing so hot here, so instead of keeping on with our own game industry, we're just going to let everybody else use our things, because we're the nice guys here. Right. We want everyone to win.
Imagine if Uplay was like, you know what, this just isn't working out. So you know what, Steam, you can have them.
Yeah, exactly. Has nothing to do with our catastrophic failure or anything now. It's just we want to be the nice guy here. Not that Disney Infinity was a catastrophic
failure. Corporations have your best interests at heart. They always have and always will.
That's right. So it is. It's surprising. I wanted to ask sort of like a pseudo-related question here for Mathis in particular. So with the Amiibo collection you've got right now, right? Mm-hmm. There's not a lot of like actual practical use for them.
Not at all.
Right now?
But not really. Like... for Smash Brothers, all the Smash Brothers characters you can scan in, and then they can level, and they get to like level 50, and they can like just pose a challenge. Mm-hmm. In Zelda, the Twilight Princess remaster, certain Zelda figures will do different things. Like if you scan the Ganondorf amiibo, it'll make all the hits hit you harder. There's like less power-ups. If you scan the Zelda amiibo, it'll heal you completely, but you can only do that like once every 24 hours. It is a bunch
weird.
It's not. There's no real like. There's no toy sets or anything for Amiibos. There's no real reason to have them other than like these.
It's just
weird
a collector's
bonuses.
Item, right?
For me, it's just a collector's
item. Yeah. So that was the grander question I was getting to. Yeah, exactly. It's like I think for the most part, people are probably buying these just to say like, cool. I like having this thing, so I'm gonna buy it, right? Like,
was there a dungeon? Dungeon tied to an amiibo in the Twilight Princess remake.
Oh yeah, I think
there is one that maybe is like the Wolf Link with what's her face Midna riding in, which gets packaged with the game.
Oh, okay, so it's with it.
Yeah, and that's it's like a challenge dungeon though. It's not even like a real dungeon. It's just like a challenge. Mm. So
all right, cool. All right, well. Unfortunate news there, of course. Anytime a studio is closed, that means people lose their jobs, so it sucks. So best wishes to them, but hopefully they get back on their feet, and we're going to move on from that to...
One day, automation is going to reach a level where the robots will take all of our jobs, so, I mean...
I apologize.
If anything, I envy them for being thrown from the mantle of... you know, archaic society earlier than the rest of us.
I apologize for presuming that human empathy wouldn't be obsolete within the near future. My bad.
They're going to build the new society or post-scarcity society when the robots take over all the menial labor. So
3D printers or Grey Goose scenario? Which way are we going on that?
Well, I don't know. I'm thinking more like the 3D printers, like AI running amok, something like that.
Okay, sure. Yeah, that's fine.
Cool. All right. Well, speaking of future improvements, how about Civ 6? Civilization 6 announced an October release date. That's that Sid Meier guy. You remember him?
Sid Meier.
I know. I'm goofing.
Isn't he friends with Shin Megami Tensei?
Civilization VI has been announced this week. If you have never experienced the Civilization game before, I recommend it because they're pretty damn good. The most recent one was Civilization Beyond Earth, came out in 2013 or 2014. Was it? I think it was 2014, wasn't it?
Civ 5? I think it was like 2012.
Civ Beyond Earth was
Beyond Earth.
Oh, Civ Beyond Earth.
I think Civ 5 was like 2010 even. I think Civ 5 was a little while before that even. But I personally felt like Beyond Earth, I think a lot of people actually share this sentiment. Beyond Earth was sort of like just a glorified Civ 5 expansion, more or less.
Reskin mod type thing.
Yeah. So, well, I kind of want to pull the audience here, too. You guys big Civilization fans here?
It's consistently, like, one of the top 10 or top 20 played games on Steam, even now. Mm-hmm. Civ 5 is, at least. A long time. Yeah, like, right now, it's fourth on Steam. And nobody talks about Civ 5 ever. So the fact that the game has, like, staying power like this is ridiculous.
Yeah, it is insane.
I mean, it has a ton of people that own the game, obviously, because it's been out forever and been in sales and even Humble Bundles and stuff like that. But it is like 10% lower in current players than Stellaris. Actually, no, right now it's 200 less players than Stellaris.
That's really good. Wow.
Yeah. That's amazing. Stellaris is full price and just came out. But at the same time, Civ 5 is like 5 years old. Mm-hmm. So... There's a lot of Civ 5.
How many are there for Beyond Earth right now, out of curiosity?
That's a great question.
Players? Yeah, I wonder.
But, I'm guessing that it's fair to say that we're all pretty familiar with, if not fans of the series. Personally, I am actually really looking forward to a few things they've already announced. Of course, with Civilization 5, one of the bigger changes that they made to the way that the military units work was you could no longer stack units together on the same tile. Instead, you had to build units and put them in different tiles in order to sort of like make a strategic approach to taking over a city, as opposed to just stacking a shitload of units on the same tile and just pouring them nonstop into the enemy. So I was a fan of that, of course. I think just in general that makes things a lot better for the combat. You know, like it takes away the cheese, which is regrettable because I am a fan of good cheese every now and then. But I think for the most part it ended up being better. They've continued to just build off of the framework that I think was just basically Civilization 2, right? Like Civilization as a game mostly just has not changed. Like the core game of Civilization has not really changed for basically 25 years, right? It's been the same since the first one came out. But they've just continued to add more and more stuff and diversify and change aspects of it, more or less. Is there anything particular you guys are, like, looking forward to, maybe? Something you'd want to see changed in Civilization VI?
I did not put as nearly as much time into Civ 5 that I feel like I should have, so I don't really have room to comment on what I want to see changed, because I did not put much time into 5, unfortunately. I hear 5 got good after Brave New World.
It did, yeah, expansion. Definitely.
Honestly, the base version of 5, I think, is pretty good, but I'm, like, compared to the average strategy gamer, I'm probably a little bit less picky, but I only have, like, 40 or 50 hours in Civ 5, which is pretty minimal compared to, you know, the amount of time that some people put into those games.
Yeah, I was going to say, that like sounds like a lot for a lot of games, but for Civilization, that's actually just not too much.
Exactly. Yeah, like that was enough for me to win, like, a few games on one difficulty higher than normal. But, like, it's pretty good, and I think I basically, once every 4 years, get really into whatever the most recent Civ game is. So I'm just excited for, like, a fresh coat of paint, and I'm not super worried about strategic changes. And at this point, I really trust Firaxis to handle their properties with respect. Mm-hmm. Like, they did right by XCOM twice.
Yeah.
Potentially three times, depending on how you feel about Enemy Within. And the Civ 5 apparently got a lot better with expansions, even though I thought the base game was good. So I'm excited for Civ 6, even though Beyond Earth wasn't really my cup of tea. I see a lot of people saying, like, well, why would I play Civ when I could play, like, Paradox Grand Strategy? And I kind of think
they're different.
They're different enough. Like, Civ is, like, it's not quite a digital board game, but it's way less of, like, a digital spreadsheet, which I guess is what all
that's a really good way of saying it, actually. That I thought a lot about that, because I think now, especially now that Stellaris is out, I think a lot of people are going to be making that argument of, well, I it's going to take a lot for me to be pulled away from one grand strategy or 4X game to another, right? But there's just something in particular about Civilization that has a lasting appeal that makes people continue to play it 5 or 6 years after its release in droves.
Well, a new person can open up Civ and play, and a new person cannot open up EU4 and just play.
Yeah, that's
you
definitely...
You need a friend who's an expert and has 40,000 hours in it to guide you through the first 10 hours of your own first campaign.
Once you understand EU4, there's a layer of complexity there that just does not exist in Civ. However, Civ is infinitely more approachable.
Mm-hmm. And from like a historical standpoint, Civ is like watching the History Channel or something, or like reading historical fiction, and EU4 or CK2 are like cracking open like Norman Cantor's A History of Medieval Europe. Like, it's nice to have like something you can go to when you're like, I'm kind of like a casual fan of history, but I want to play a Dutch leader, but I don't want to have to start in the Netherlands. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I don't want to have all the disadvantages that I would have relative to my neighbors. I just want to, like, everybody starts with one city and
we go.
You know, branch out from there. Right. We're all starting from the same part. But I'm still, like, I have Dutch ideas or whatever.
Dutch ideas sometimes.
Whatever I forget what the historical flair is for countries to countries. But it's like if you start as Caesar, your phalanxes get, like, plus 10 attack or something like that.
Yeah.
I think... The approachability argument is probably the number one that people would make. Stellaris, though, I think is, you know, I wouldn't say it's as approachable, as easy to get into, but it's definitely getting closer. So I think they're narrowing the gap there for sure.
I mean, I know we're gonna talk about Stellaris later, mm-hmm. but have any of you even played Stellaris yet?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, good. No, you haven't, Ryan.
It's a lot more
approachable than any of Paradox's other games by a long shot.
Mm-hmm.
But we could talk about it.
Can I ask you about Civ 6? Because from an outsider's perspective of Civilization, someone played like a really small number of hours. It's history, strategy, not really my things, but I have tried it. And I respect that people like it. I have no ill will towards people who are into it. I just personally didn't get into it.
Mm-hmm.
So I looked at the Steam page for Civ 6, and I was like, hey, it says there's like cities that span multiple tiles. Yep. And that was like their biggest selling point. And also it kind of looked just like Civ 5 to me, although maybe I am having nostalgia goggles.
I don't get that vibe at all, actually. I think Civ 6 graphics have actually sort of been a note of controversy almost. Like people
They've been cartoonized in a much more...
People might just be misremembering it then. That might just be on me.
You might be looking at different screenshots or something too, but the Civilization 6 graphical changes are definitely noteworthy. Unfortunately have been saying things like it looks like a mobile game or something like that, which is not...
It kind of looks like Age of Empires Online.
Or like Civ Revolution. Did you ever play those?
It does definitely look like Civ Revolution, yeah.
Get into any of them. I don't know what it is, but that game just drives me away. I actually found I liked EU4 more than I liked Civ for some reason, which seems completely absurd.
But maybe it's just because I had Rob with me to help. That surprises me. I'm wondering then, like, what it is about Civ that is unapproachable for you. If EU4 was better.
It doesn't take it seriously enough for how serious it is for a concept. It's really wishy-washy. Mm. I don't really know how to describe it.
Yeah, I won't put you on blast or anything here, but... What was the first part before you said about the graphics? You mentioned something else.
I was trying to understand what the big selling point is for why you'd want Civ 6 over Civ 5, and it seemed like they were just pointing out that cities could span multiple tiles.
Mm-hmm. So that,
I didn't know what that meant.
That is like the tile system. There's like the hexagonal tile system that Civilization employs. I'm sure you're vaguely familiar with it at least, right?
Yeah.
Where units move from tile to tile. And typically, cities will only occupy a single tile, no matter how many buildings or wonders or whatever you want to do you put in that city. It will still just all stay within the same tile. And it sounds like what they want to do for Civilization VI is make it so the construction of buildings, the construction of wonders, is more than just an industrial and economical decision. It's also a geographical and physical decision of where do I want to put this in relation to where I want my enemies to funnel through, or where I want my armies to go, or what I want to have protected. it actually sounds like it's opening up a lot of different possibilities, too. Like, you consider things like, for example, if you have to build a market and that occupies a tile space, then that means that tile space must be vulnerable to attack, right? That it would stand to reason that that's something you can target independently with an army. So that sounds really interesting to me. It sounds like it opens up different strategies, different plans of attack, different like modes of warfare, you know, like some sort of economical standoff or something like that, which would be really interesting.
I understand now, and that makes sense, and that seems like a big improvement. I just wonder why they didn't make it a bit more open, that's what that meant for people who had no clue. But maybe they don't care about that. I don't know.
Well, maybe. it's not outside the realm of possibility that they don't necessarily need to attract a bunch of new people here, right? Yeah. Like they've already got a well-retained audience.
I'm excited to see what AI improvements they end up making in Civ 6 too, because a common complaint from Civ 4 and Civ 5 is that the AI is kind of predictable and dumb.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And that's something I would like to see changed in 6. But I think you can say that for most strategy games. Like, you would like to see the AI be different. AI, like, at least in EU4 with AI, like, you can break them down by pure numbers. I mean, you can open the ledger in EU4 and just look at all the numbers. Like, you're like, how much of an army do they have down to the last soldier? How much are they bringing in? Mm-hmm. So, like, the AI, it doesn't matter how good it is in EU4. You can always kind of just break it down. But I know people have been saying, like, I hope Civ 6 has a much improved AI system.
Yeah, it sounds like that is something they're going to be focusing on as well. Of course, like, you know, there's always there's basically what's evolved to a meme now of Gandhi nukes everyone, right? Which is always fun. But, you know, it does seem like they can just be provoked to war for no discernible reason for a lot of instances as well. Especially in the early game, it seems like any small provocation ends up causing you your entire civilization. So I think that's probably going to be one of their focal points as well. I hope so, too.
So I kind of feel like Civ is, I don't want to use the digital board game thing too much, but I kind of like do not care about new features at all. Like, if you came out with like a new game of Battleship and you're like, oh, check out my new features, I'd be like, I don't really care that much. I'm excited for like a new Civ, and the tweaks that they make to the gameplay are secondary to me to the fact that it's going to have a fresh coat of paint, and, you know, it's another convenient opportunity to get into it kind of on the ground floor and enjoy that swell as the enthusiasm comes in. But it's hard to sell, admittedly, I think. I mean, like, Civ 4 is still very playable. Civ 5 is still very playable. Mm, I mean, Civ 5, as far as I'm concerned, that game still looks really great. And from a UI design perspective, it still looks modern, which it's not really that dated. But I'm excited for Civ 6 nonetheless. I'm sure it'll follow the Civ release enthusiasm curve, which is it'll peak at release, and then 2 days later people will be like, oh, I'm going back to Civ 5, and then 6 months down the road they'll start releasing the DLC and people will be like, finally,
this is what I wanted.
It's already
happening with Stellaris, which is hilarious. People are like, this is great, but I want this, I'll come back in 6 months when they release the expansion and make it a complete game.
Just a quick little note here, too. I think it's interesting that the whole fresh coat of paint thing, as far as a game genre like this is concerned, like, there's not a lot you can do to make it look that much better for this genre of game, you know? Like, I think as far as applying more detail to characters or to environments or things like that, you tend to, for the most part, stay pretty far zoomed out so you can see, like, an overarching view of the map, right? Yeah. So it is... I actually, for that reason maybe alone, I'm sort of glad that they've now gone into this more cartoonized art style, because oftentimes you zoom out and it all just sort of seems like this hexagonal mess that isn't really that easy to discern or to pick apart the individual pieces of. But I think the addition of new color palettes, hopefully like an actual vibrant scheme, may end up being a little bit better for the actual gameplay too. So that might be nice.
Yeah, I think they kind of reach a point with that where really quality of life improvements are all you can expect. The detail's going to get as nice as it needs to be. Resolution's going to go up as high as it needs to be. Mm-hmm. Frame rate's perfect already. So you just focus it all on AI and making the UI as intuitive as possible. And from there, I guess that's where you get to the good stuff.
Yeah, hopefully some performance bumps as well. I will mention that while Civ 5 is still awesome, it did have a little bit of slowdown for me, especially when you start to get more and more stuff piled on into the game. So hopefully... Better performance overall. Obviously, that's, you know, sort of an assumption that we hope to make without it being stated. Yeah, I think that's about the gist of it. I'm excited. I'm really excited to play it. I am definitely looking forward to another major entry in the Civ series. It's really good stuff.
Yeah, I am excited as well.
Okay, let's do WESA. WESA gonna do some esports. Announcing the founding of the World Esports Association. Oh man, it's never gonna end. It's only just beginning here today. The World Esports Association, after over a year of intense negotiations, the ESL is excited to announce the World Esports Association in conjunction with 8 teams have been announced to team up with the WESA. That includes Fnatic, Natus, Vincere. I'm going to butcher a few of these, I'm sure.
Envious. It's Na'Vi.
Yeah, Na'Vi.
No, it's not Na'Vi. It's
Natus, Vincere.
Okay. Virtus Pro, G2 Esports, FaZe, Mouse Sports, and Ninjas in Pajamas. The overview here is this is more or less what FIFA is to soccer, what the NBA is to basketball. It's sort of like the governing body of this new world of esports that is now blossoming into the sort of infrastructure that just welcomes all sorts of corporate ties and scheming and political nonsense that we all just love to see in a brooding atmosphere. So here's the FIFA equivalent here for esports. So general impressions then, I want to go around real quick. How do you guys feel this will affect esports in general?
I feel like this is something that was kind of destined to happen, but at the same point, considering that these organizations have existed for a while, I'm sort of like, how can you just step in and be like, we're the authority?
Yeah.
Like, this is founded by ESL, and I'm reading, like, they didn't consult MLG or CEVO Dream for Counter-Strike Act. Stuff
no,
at all.
I'm pretty sure, like, nobody's really notified.
You're like, well, of course they didn't, because they're competitors. But at the same time, it's a really messy area of like we're just popping out of nowhere. Like, hey, we're the people that are gonna adhere and administrate to this league in the future. Not just the league, but like the whole genre of esports. Yeah. So, it seems like a power play for sure. Now, is it going to provide stuff that is going to be beneficial for esports in the future? Possibly. Having some standardization maybe would be nice. I guess a governing body to ensure the teams and players get paid on time.
Yeah.
Which happens all the time, that players aren't being paid by their teams or teams aren't being paid their tournament winnings in a timely fashion. But at the same time, it's kind of like, you know, out of this Wild West, there's got to be some kind of order that comes out, but do you want this to be it? Maybe yes, maybe not.
Yeah, we were joking earlier about how I am pretty glad I'm not an esports pro in the current landscape, just because it does sound like there's all sorts of hell you have to go through. Not to say that the only thing stopping me from being a Hearthstone pro is the fact that I don't think it would be that appealing. But, you know, it is sort of daunting to see the loopholes and the frustrations a lot of these players are having to deal with. And it sounds like what they want and what they need is an organization that's going to be looking out for the players' interests. They have, like, the player council, apparently, that they're going to be including in this organization, which is a good thing to see out of the gate. But as you mentioned, it is also really interesting that they can just sort of say, it's us. That it's like they're the first at the top of the mountain and they planted the flag, right? That's, I guess, how it works in the legal sense of things is, well, no one said they were doing this, so now we are, and that's how it's going to be.
Without getting too much into it, to be fair, this is what we were trying to sell certain organizations on for Rocket League last summer. Mm. We're like, hey, this doesn't exist. If you just throw money at it, it'll get huge.
Yeah.
And do it before the other side does it, and you'll. I mean, not that it's not doing well right now, but anyway, that's an aside.
No, I do. But, I like that comparison though.
It's like these companies are duking it out, and there's nothing above them, so they basically get to make up the rules. But I don't know. It seems like, I don't know if you want the company that organizes. It's hard to say because, like, it is how it works in sports. Like, there's an NFL, there's an NHL. There used to be, you know, the American Basketball Association and blah, blah, blah. But it seems a little shady. Apparently, the teams got paid $150,000 each to join.
Really?
That may just be
already.
That may just be a rumor, but it's from a respected CS:GO caster.
Mm-hmm. I wouldn't be surprised to learn that for sure.
Throwing money at it to make it work.
Mm-hmm. Man, that is interesting. That actually I had something else, but that totally threw me off my train of thought. Damn, that's big. What the approach is, like you meant, like, oh, okay, I remember now. So the NFL comparison, right? So before the NFL took, like, the controlling and complete dominance over the entirety of American football, there was the AFL and the NFL, right? The American Football League and the National Football League, and those merged together. That could probably happen in the current climate of esports. I actually would not be too surprised to see, like, a competing association come together in a couple of years, or maybe even sooner than that, that may, like, almost be a competitor with the WESA, the WESA, because there's, like, it's such an open landscape still. People are just sort of ironing out their own, they're etching out their own space in it, and it's all just a completely blank slate. So, you know, they can almost just decide on the fly how it's all going to work out. So there very well could just be a competitor showing up anytime.
I feel like the ideal outcome for this would be Valve stepping in for CS:GO, like a different organization for each game.
It should be noted that this is for only CS:GO at the moment.
Oh, yeah, okay. Then specifically for CS:GO, I would like if Valve stepped in and was just like, hey, we're going to handle this. It's our game. And we're going to do what you would do, except it's in the interest of the game and the community as opposed to the financial interests of you, the broadcasting entity. But I can understand that from their perspective, they're like, whoa, this game is making a lot of money, and I don't have to do very much at all. Right? Like, why give myself more of a headache?
That's like the whole company, man. Like, whoa,
I know.
Whoa, we're making a lot of money, and we're not even doing anything.
People can't stop buying these keys. This is great. And then you're like, well, why would I take on a very sticky situation of actually, like, managing these things if somebody is volunteering to do it and putting that risk up themselves? So, I mean, I can relate to that. And in the end, I guess you have to wait and see if it'll work out. But I have to imagine that MLG after this is going to be like, well, okay, I'll tell you what, here's our governing body.
Yeah,
we're gonna, you know, your teams can't play with our teams. What you don't want to have is, like, the MLG tournament only has MLG teams, and the ESL tournament only has ESL teams. You got, like, two world champions simultaneously, and, like, that's not good for anybody.
MLG will no longer accept ESL competitors competing representing the WESA for Team FNA TIC, and everybody just got way too many acronyms to remember, man.
That's,
it's just a
that's
mess.
That's not
after
an
that.
Acronym. That's just fanatic.
I tried to make one more at the tail end. Didn't work out.
If Valve stepped in, I mean, I think, like you said, that'd be the ideal because, like you said, it is their game and they can do what they did with Dota.
Yeah.
They can integrate everything into the game. I mean, the International is, like, fully integrated into Dota 2 with the compendium and stuff. That's something ESL can't really do. And if Valve was like, all right, well, we're going to have our International for CS:GO, and here's all the things we're going to integrate into the game for those who can't participate because they're just, you know, casual players but want to be involved. This is going to be all, like, we can do so much with it, and the ESL just does not have that capability because it's Valve's game.
Because this was made by ESL, I think we just have to have such an air of skepticism about it, right? Like, I think really the only way this is a good entity is if they first and foremost look out for the rights of the players. And it just doesn't sound like that's what the aim is. Here, if they've thrown, like, nearly $1 million, it sounds like, at just getting teams to sign on to this organization from the get-go, and obviously they are willing to put the money into that because the teams that they've got on board are big names. They have widespread appeal that will probably get a lot of people to validate the legitimacy of the WESA just by virtue of those name associations alone, right? So it only seems like a business move at this stage. And I just struggle to believe that what their top priority will be moving forward is just player rights, because that's really like the only noble cause, I guess, that I can concoct from this. Nick, do you have any points you want to make?
We went from strategy and history to sports and business.
We did.
This is, I'm the least informed to help you with this discussion, I'm sorry to say.
That's all right. I didn't know if you were like brooding or if you were just intentionally sitting
not
out.
Brooding. Okay. I honestly just don't really have an opinion for this kind of thing. It's cool, man. Like if there becomes a governing body for esports, I probably still won't watch esports, but I'm glad somebody's getting paid and having a good time.
I am hopeful that it is what it claims to be, you know. Like I'm just a little worried that will end up being just the precedent is set already based on the fact that as recently as like last year, we were hearing about was the ridiculous amounts of widespread corruption in FIFA, right? Like the taste in people's mouths now is that organizations like these solely exist to be corrupt, if only to like give a bunch of rich people more money. But yeah.
See, that's where I don't want to get too involved in talking, because you already know my opinions on those topics.
That's true. But it is, it's definitely interesting. I'll be keeping tabs on it for sure, the WISA movement. Good stuff.
No, don't do it.
All right. Let's talk about some games. Want to do that? Let's talk about, let's talk about Blockhood. Ryan, you want to tell me about Blockhood?
Yeah, okay. Mm-hmm. I'm really excited about Blockhood. Blockhood is a strategy / puzzle / city builder that is a game where instead of just building a city where your aim is typically to have the largest population you possibly can, or, you know, build your city in your image, you're actually building like a community or a neighborhood. So it's much more like size restricted, and instead of building out, you build up, basically. Mm-hmm. So you're not really building a city so much as you're building an apartment complex with like surrounding flora and fauna that supports itself and is self-sustaining. So it has a lot of verticality to it, and instead of rather than compare it or contrast it with other city builders like City Skylines, it's basically about kind of keeping yourself and your community in touch with the environment with a variety of different spectrums. Like, for example, one of the missions, and it's split into like sandbox and like self-contained puzzles, you have to make 1,000 units of beer without making more than 100 units of wheat, which sounds like it'd be easy. Oh, I'll just build some breweries, but not as many wheat farms. But in order to make beer, you need breweries. Breweries require wheat and make organic waste and beer. To get wheat, you need to have labor. Labor is produced by small apartments, which also produce organic waste, but people will only come to live in those apartments if you also have water, electricity, fresh air, leisure, et cetera, et cetera. So really, you know, it's that, you know, Carl Sagan line of like, you know, if you want to bake an apple pie, first you got to create the universe. Like, mm-hmm. In order to complete the objectives, you actually have to create like a self-sustaining city that's really cool. And then you just kind of like, you're like, okay, let's add like two breweries. And then you're making enough beer to actually make this happen. It is like a vertical sim city is a fair way to describe it, I think. It's not really much of a people manager. There's no traffic simulation or anything like that. You don't have to micromanage. You don't have to be like, oh, this guy lives here, but his office is on the 900th floor. Like, he can't get there. It all just sort of works. And in the end, you're basically just looking at a chart, and you're like, this resource we're using too much, I will make more of it, and then that's going to affect the system in a different way, and so on and so forth.
The systems, I think, are what are the most appealing for me about this game, just the way that everything works together so well. I think the balance of the way that you accumulate resources and spend them is done really well. I think just the overall balance for the entirety of the game is pretty outstanding, so kudos there. I got a pretty strong Ute Tower vibe from it as well. I think I've mentioned before I played a ton of Ute Tower back in the day, and it was sort of the same principle where you take away some of the maybe less forgiving aspects of city builders, like the traffic, like you mentioned, and a lot of just the person management stuff, and instead you're focusing on building just systems that work in tandem with one another, which is really, yes. I think, what was a lot of fun about U-Tower for me, too. It's good
okay,
stuff.
Okay, I gotta ask, has anyone here played Sim Tower? Because nobody made the comparison throughout it.
I was thinking about making the comparison, but I've only played like a minimal amount of it.
Okay, I love Sim Tower. It was one of my Sim Ant and Sim Tower, as stupid as that sounds, are some of my favorite Sims games. Oh, so man. This sounds really cool to me, and also it sounds a little like it's got some big pharma mixed in, which I like too. So
yeah, this
could be good for me.
I drew that comparison myself. Not in the video, but I was talking about like Infinifactory, and Big Pharma was another one that I should have talked about, because it is a lot about, as boring as this sounds, it's a lot about like process automation and just making a system that basically runs itself, which is really cool. But it has an added level of customization in the sense that you can build your apartment to basically look however you want it to look, and it leads to some cool consequences because you can only build vertically past a certain point. So like in my sandbox game right now, let's go down this rabbit hole again. To make money, you need businesses. So I have bars and beer gardens. In order for those to run, they need labor and also electricity, but also beer. So you go down the beer rabbit hole again. In the end, I need a lot of wheat. So I basically have just like one skyscraper, and every single floor is like six wheat fields. So instead of having like a sprawling wheat field, I have this cool kind of like futuristic vertical farm that handles all the needs, and then every few floors there's like you know, like an anaerobic digester or something that produces fertilizer to use on the wheat fields, and then there's breweries near the wheat fields so that they can make the beer, and it's really cool. Like the cities and the communities that you build in it end up looking really interesting, despite the fact that I have like no flair for design whatsoever.
Is it set in the future?
I don't think it's necessarily set in the future, but it is very modern.
It sounds pretty utopian, doesn't it? The idea of a vertical farm. I like that.
Yes.
I was just wondering if it has a jumping off point toward going toward maybe some fictional stuff that could be done towards the end, or if there's like a win condition that gets a little goofy or weird compared to what we would expect.
There is no win condition outside of the specific challenge.
Goal completion.
Yeah, like the goal completion, the ones that I've seen so far are basically produce X amount of a resource, and I'm like 2/3 of the way through those, and it's still just like making, you know, bread. Make this much bread without storing more than this much wheat. But there are, like, I'm not sure if it's futuristic, but, like, modern modules that you can make, like a mist collector, where if you have learned citizens, they can work at the mist collector, which collects moisture from the air to make water, basically. I don't know enough about industry to know if those are viable on a population scale, but...
Matt Damon simulator.
Exactly.
Is there a lose condition?
Not really, but there are some times where you're just going to like want to quit. Like there's two things that can cause your building to kind of like, or your community to start to get into trouble. One of them is lack of access. So if you don't have the ability for units to get from X place to Y place, they'll decay. If they go through like 10 production cycles without having any production, they decay. The other one is like, let's say you've got a farm, but you have no water, then that will decay as well. And then, you know, it's that kind of like you pull out one Jenga piece and eventually the whole thing's going to go down. If your water tower doesn't have electricity, you're not making water, which means that people can't live in their homes, which means they don't have labor to work in the buildings, which means you're not making money, et cetera, et cetera.
Go from X place to Y place to F place, basically.
Exactly. And then dead place.
Dead place.
What's cool is you actually don't use money to build the modules. So it's a little bit less strict of a lose condition, where in something like City Skylines, they're like, you have 150,000 simoleons, but if you run out, you can just get like a loan. But if you run out after that, then you're in trouble.
You're gonna have words.
instead, what happens is you like run out of money, and then things that require money no longer function properly, and it starts to fall apart. But you could theoretically place like 10 businesses right after you did that and maybe get yourself out of the death spiral. But it's a game, it's about equilibrium. It's about balance.
Cool.
It's really neat and meditative. Like it's therapeutic to play for sure.
Yeah, definitely relaxing. That was a point I was gonna make while you were asking about like the win and lose conditions. I don't necessarily think about it as that sort of game. It's more of just like Ryan said, it's like a therapeutic game, you know? It's a sit back for a few hours and build some block neighborhoods game.
Yeah, how much have you played, Bear?
Only a couple of hours. I played the first few challenges, and I did a little bit of the sandbox mode as well. I thought it was... well, I actually didn't end up even getting into the more complex systems just because I was on a limited frame of time, honestly. That was really the only thing that was preventing me. But I ended up just like watching a few videos of people playing the later stages and playing through some of the more complex stuff. And it definitely looks like something I want to get back into, too. So it's exciting. It's fun. I like it a lot.
That is something that I think works against the game a little bit, is that it's really... overwhelming, especially if you were like, I don't want to do the hardcore stuff in the challenge mode, let me just do sandbox. Mm-hmm. And then you're like, oh, there's 140 buildings.
Yeah.
Like, you really need to go like through the tutorials and then probably like through five or six challenges. Otherwise, you're like, okay, well, I built an anaerobic digester, and then that produces biogas, and biogas can be it can generate power, but produces pollution. So I got to put like a bamboo farm over here, and like you can tell the dude who's making it is a genius, and maybe even a little bit past the point of it being good for the game. Like, there's a lot of. There's a lot of resources that feed back into each other and then come back out the other side and feed back into the original resource. But the challenge mode does a pretty good job of like incrementally introducing them.
Yeah, I definitely agree with that. I think the tutorials are pretty well done too. I think like for the most part get you familiar with just about everything you need to know to be able to do what you want to do. But the sandbox mode's variety is another appeal to it, too. Although it should be said that I find just a lot of the resources just don't really seem like they're significant, or definitely not as significant as many of the others, you know, like just sort of extra stuff for extra stuff's sake a lot of the time. But, you know, it is, I guess, also just kind of up to me since this is a city builder, you know. Like, if I want to go that route, then I'm going to go that route. But it didn't really... have a lot of reason to, but I guess that's just
there
a
is
personal
like,
thing.
There's a tier list for sure. Yeah. Like, you need electricity, water, labor, and money. Mm-hmm. And then after that, and leisure and fresh air. But then after that, if you're like, well, I'm producing too much gray water, you're like, all right, well, so
better
be
sell
it.
The gray excess. Water?
Gray water is like water that needs to be Alien treated. Dish. So you send the gray water to an algae farm.
You get the amoebas.
Etc. Etc. Mm-hmm. So,
is there a collection aspect? Like, can you collect all the resources and then say you're done with the game because you've done all the things there are to do, or something
don't
like that?
Don't believe so. No.
I don't think so. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's more of just like that's sort of what I'm saying. Is like there's not a lot of reason to do it, but you just sort of
that's
have to create that yourself. Yeah, exactly.
There is it's early access as well, and there's kind of like one module on the quick bar that is like for advanced production, advanced. Residential, advanced, whatever, and that stuff has not been implemented yet. And there's also there's a spectrum, a property, I guess, of structural integrity that shows up in the view model for the game, but I don't think you can actually build something that's so shitty that it collapses yet. But I think you may have to worry about structural integrity later on. And it also has a view spectrum for land value, so maybe that's another system that'll be integrated later, like people don't want to live on the bottom of your tower next to the wind turbines. They want to live on like the 80th floor, but it's more expensive up there. So I don't know. It's like a little mini Dwarf Fortress in that there's a lot of stuff going on at all times.
Yeah, I agree. And it's got a pretty good foundation too. As you mentioned, it's in early access. So I think there's a lot to build off of here from the groundwork that's been laid. It's pretty encouraging.
Ground up.
Something I plan on playing later today. You got me very interested in it. I just have not had any time to check it out.
It's a cool game.
Right on. All right. Right on. Let me talk about another game I was paid to play, if you wouldn't mind me doing so real quick right here.
Wasn't paid to play Blockhood, just for the record here.
I was paid to play Tasty Lethal Tactics, and I want to get that disclaimer out here before I talk about it. I thought it was pretty good. It's Frozen Synapse-like, set in the Old West. So if you've played Frozen Synapse or Frozen Cortex even, you probably have a pretty good idea of what the actual gameplay is like. If you haven't, it's a turn-based strategy tactics game. Surprisingly complex, actually. So you've got about 12 characters to choose from, I think. You've got three in your support class, three of the gunners, I guess you'd call them, three snipers and then three like heavy grenade guys. You set the default. Me and Tenchi actually were playing some multiplayer games. HJ Tenchi, highly recommended. Good Twitch streamer, love that guy. He and I were playing some multiplayer games that were 4-on-4, and it was it got to the point where we were actually like employing a great deal of strategy in what we're doing. So there's, for each character, they have their own unique skill, which for the sniper, for example, could be like the Vanish, which allows him to turn invisible for a couple of seconds. You've got somebody who's got a flashbang you can use to knock out the vision on one of your enemy characters in order to allow you to move around a little bit more stealthily. They got little things like that, but they all also have the ability to sprint, crouch, stand, and all sorts of other little stuff. So you have to actually give them those commands while they're moving around the battlefield. So that frozen synapse or cortex style of gameplay is made a little bit more complex by the fact that you also have to consider, okay, so I'm going to move over here, crouch down, move past this smaller barricade while I'm crouched, then stand, sprint to this next area, and then be on the lookout for an enemy while I'm like scouting this out for my other guy who's going to follow me up from behind. So it ended up being like surprisingly strategic and tactical. I was really pretty pleasantly surprised by it.
Can I ask you a question?
Of course.
No.
Why is it named after a character from Orange is the New Black?
Yeah. It's a good question,
Tasty
man.
Tasty Lethal Tactics.
I couldn't tell you, yeah. Tasty Lethal Tactics.
The honestly don't understand the name at all. Like,
well,
does that mean?
I can tell you.
Tasty that must be like Tactical Assault Squad.
Oh, okay. It's an acronym. For some reason, it's in your register as one.
That sound, no, you got something going there. Tactical Assault Squad to End Earth. Oh.
Wait, is that what you're doing in this game?
I hope not.
Wait, do you End Earth? I might be into it.
And Tasty's, you know, like, the boring answer is that Tasty's, like, the name of the bar, the restaurant, whatever that's in the game that the level is built around. So that's the whole thing. But
what okay.
Does it stand for?
Mm-hmm.
It needs to stand for something.
I enjoyed it quite a bit. I was really, again, pleasantly surprised by the level of detail in the maps, too. I thought it was pretty cool. The fact, not only just graphically, I thought it was pretty impressive, but also you want to pay close attention to that because your sight lines are heavily dependent on just like those little tiny gaps in whether it be like a little window that you can see through or just like a barricade that gives you some space to see the opponent. But you got to be like really mindful of that going all around the map. So it was really pretty fun.
You guys, you're going to like this.
Oh, what am I
when we
like?
Began development on our game, we chose the code name Tasty, which stood for Tactical Asynchronous Simultaneous Turn-Based E word we never figured out. And I also happen to have recently finished watching Orange is the New Black.
Oh, yeah. All right.
Oh,
there you go.
Man. I had no idea.
Well done, man.
Clever.
Right. Disappointing.
E word we never figured out. I'm glad they at least made an effort there. But there you go. Tactical Assault Squad to End Earth. I hope you guys use that one. There you go. I liked Tasty. I thought it was a good time.
I have to say that the Steam reviews for this are tickling my fancy.
Mm-hmm.
It's saying, referencing a lot of games I'm a big fan of.
Yeah.
If you like Frozen Synapse and Door Kickers, you will like this game. Mm-hmm. Out of the other two, this is much more fun. I don't know. I thought those games were pretty good.
I wouldn't say that.
One of the better top-down tacticals I own. It's been compared to Frozen Synapse and Door Kickers, but I think it's much better than both. That's very encouraging.
Is that the same guy?
No, it's a different one.
Wow.
This one's just insulting.
People said the same thing?
Wait, what's the insulting one?
This is basically Frozen Synapse with graphics. Yo, Frozen Synapse has a very deliberate artistic style that works well with the aesthetic of the narrative, okay?
No, I think he meant, like, literally, they didn't have any graphics in Frozen Synapse, right? That was that was all a text-based game.
Yeah.
I think actually you would like Tasty quite a bit. Did you guys play Hard West? Did anybody play Hard West?
Yes.
Yeah, so if you liked Hard West, you'll probably like Tasty too.
So yeah, I was actually going to ask if it was similar to Hard West. Because, like, definitely in environment, it looks similar.
Definitely that. I think, the gameplay is, it's Frozen Synapse / Frozen Cortex. Like, there's no arguing that. It's basically the same thing. But I think, yeah, as far as the actual environments and the characters in Tasty are a lot more goofy. They're a lot more like Team Fortress 2 style characters instead of stuff like Hard West, which is a lot more serious in nature. But if that is not a deterrent, then yeah, I think absolutely Tasty is a pretty good recommendation, I'd say.
I'm going to check it out.
Mm-hmm. $10 on Steam right now. Came out in, it came out a few days ago. Yep, brand new. There you go. That's tasty. Now let's talk about Stellaris, Mathis.
You talking about me? Sylvester Stellaris. I've been waiting for this moment for quite some time.
Mathis, talk about Stellaris for me.
Well, how far are you in it, Bear?
I've only played about an hour and a half or so. I mostly was just going through the tutorial things, which I was very happy with, actually.
So, Stellaris, for those who don't know, is Paradox Interactive's sci-fi, their first dip into the sci-fi 4X genre. Paradox has done games like Crusader Kings 2, EU4, all these historical grand strategy games. And this is one of their first really going into sci-fi, fantasy, whatever you want to call it.
Yeah.
I'm really hooked on it right now. I have how many hours do I have in this game so far? I have about 12 hours into it so far.
That's pretty good.
I'm having a good time with it. As I've said, it's definitely one of, if not their most approachable strategy game, for a number of reasons. And I was trying to think of why, and I was talking to you about it earlier, Bear, just a bunch of people about it.
Yeah.
And one of the big reasons, there's a few reasons I've realized, but one of the big reasons I think this is more approachable than EU4 is because in EU4 or CK2, you pick a country, and then you're just thrown into this world that's already existing. You have these alliances or rivalries or wars or trade agreements with these people that already exist, and you have to kind of deal with that right when you start up the game. Where Stellaris is, you start with your little solar system. You've not met anybody else. It is the most 4X game that they've created so far in that you're starting with this tiny little empire, and you're exploring other solar systems and meeting other alien races and dealing with them on a one-on-one basis before there's any like trade agreements or alliances, and you kind of grow your empire from there. It's interesting because it's a 4X game that becomes a grand strategy, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
It's not turn-based like in Civ. It's very much Paradox of real-time, pausable. But you are like ramping up technology, building your empire, but as you meet other empires and the scale of the game becomes huge, it then becomes much more like EU4, where you're managing alliances and wars, and much like EU4 or in CK2, you can't just manually control every planet you own. There's actually like a counter in the top where you can manually control up to like 5 planets, and then any planets beyond that that you're manually controlling give you penalties until you take a sector of space and make it a sector where they're self-governing, but they're still part of your empire and pay you taxes. And as it gets bigger, it becomes a grand strategy and all this war. And there's a ton of late game stuff that I don't want to spoil that can happen. You meet things like fallen empires that exist, these precursor races that existed well before you hit space, kind of did everything you did, then just stagnated and have deemed themselves, like one fallen empire I found, deemed themselves the knowledge keepers. They have all the research, and if they see you going down any dangerous paths of research, say, for instance, you start researching AI, they will step in and they will say, stop researching AI right now, and if you don't, we're going to force you to stop researching AI.
Mm-hmm.
And you kind of have to deal with that, and you look, all right, well, how far away is this fallen empire? Oh, the other side of the galaxy? Well, fuck you, you have to get all the way over here to stop me. Or if they're right next to you, you might be like, all right, maybe I won't go down it. And if you do continue to go down it, other story things start to happen. I think this is one of Paradox's most packed games with just branching storylines and quests and late game events that just happen, and it's really replayable because of that. Outside of the fact that you can create custom governments. Now, that's not to say that there are some negatives that I have with the game as well. Like, there's no espionage, which I think kind of sucks. Trading is really basic. You kind of just bring up like a little thing, you just trade, and it's based on the numbers, like, hey, do they want to do this or do they don't? There's
it's
no
like
trade routes.
Style, right?
The trading? Yeah, basically, but I think even in Civ, I know in Paradox games you can set up trade routes that will go from city to city that will give you bonuses. Like, that doesn't exist. There's no trade routes at all. I'd love to see that brought in at some point. There's just a lot going on in the game, and it's really got me hooked. And even for what it's lacking, because of how much is to discover and how much is there, it's so replayable. Another thing I'm doing too, which I really enjoy, is you can find these primitive races. So you're scanning a solar system, you find an habitable planet, but you also find out there's this race of people that are on it, and they can be anywhere from like nomadic cavemen all the way up to like the space age, just at the cusp of coming into space and becoming their own. And you can do all kinds of different things with them. Because of my current government type, I have an observation post just watching them, and I'm slowly trying to enlighten them to bring them quicker into the space age. And if you do that, when they do hit the space age, they become a protectorate, and then over time, they will become a vassal of yours. You can do other things like infiltrate their primitive race and enslave them and just take over their planet. So you find this like race that is in a Renaissance era, and you start infiltrating them and replacing their world leaders with your race that is like, it looks like them, and you can just enslave their entire race.
That sounds more like a Paradox game, yeah. Tell me when I can just instill my bloodline into an entire race of aliens and take them over just by virtue of my birthright.
Yep. So, I mean, you can enact basically any sci-fi kind of genre there is. You want to do Star Trek, like Prime Directive stuff, where you don't interfere, you just watch them and help them, or do you just straight up... Huh?
Time travel? You said any sci-fi trope you could think of. Yeah. So.
All right, you got me.
Disappointing.
Try again.
But it's fun. There's a lot going on, and it's a really fun game. And I think if you like Paradox games, you're gonna like it. If you like Civ games, you're gonna enjoy it. It's definitely worth checking out.
I have only gone through, as I've mentioned, about an hour, so that's mostly been tutorial or tutorial stuff, just getting through my first exploration of systems and all that. But already, I am like feeling so much more confident about playing more than I ever did playing Europa Universalis or Crusader Kings 2, which, like, I can't tell you exactly what their tutorial segments were, but it felt like, you know, like, write a 5-page essay about why you deserve to play Crusader Kings 2, and then maybe we'll let you sign in. But it's like so much easier to actually just like grasp what's going on around you. And as you mentioned, I think like one of the best things they did as far as that's concerned was make it so, as you mentioned, it turns from a 4X into a grand strategy kind of slowly. Yeah. It's sort of like a frog in the pot sort of thing, right? Where you're turning the heat up on me slowly and slower until I realize, oh, hey, I'm playing a grand strategy game. Oh, I did it. Well, look at me go. Yep. I kind of need to be, like, tricked into it, right?
Yeah, I guess it's kind of like that. I think what I like about it, too, is that there are a lot of little things you can manage, but if you don't want to, you don't really have to worry about it. Mm. It can cause problems, but, like, one of the things that happens is something called ethics drifting, essentially. Mm. The further out in space you spread and, like, say you're starting integrating other races into your empire, maybe you're part of a federation, which is a chain of alliances that are made, this huge alliance, and other races start living on your planets, the ethics of that race may start rubbing off on your primary race, and they might start believing in what they believe more than what you believe, and that can cause riots, and it can cause rebellions on planets and cause them to flip. All that little stuff of just, and then you can like institute edicts where maybe only the primary species is allowed to elect the leader of your government, and no other species that is part of your empire is allowed to cast their vote. Like, that kind of thing is there, but for the most part, they did a good job that you can kind of just ignore that if you don't want to touch it, but it really helps if you decide to dive into it.
Yeah.
It's really fun.
I am looking forward to playing more, for sure. Like, did you ever play a lot of Galciv?
I did not.
Okay, so I haven't played a ton of it, but it certainly had that vibe for me as far as the navigation. I like the three-dimensional space navigation as well, and the fact that it actually, like, that does have kind of an implication gameplay-wise, too, doesn't it? The fact that you can see in that three-dimensional space, like, where your ships are actually moving?
Yep. So like, you can see where your ships are, and all combat happens in real time.
Yeah, that is awesome.
It's great.
I am excited to play more. I'm sure we'll even give it another sampling once we've had another week or so of time within it. Although you did say earlier on that there are already the people who 2 days into it now are like, oh, this would be great if only X or Y had happened, right? Is there anything?
Yeah, there's a lot of people who are like looking for particular aspects to be integrated in the game. Little things for me, I would love to have things like in EU4 where there's like a map mode where I can just click on like, show me the Alliance map mode so I know who is allied with who and who isn't. Because they give you notifications like X Empire has entered this alliance. Mm-hmm. But I don't really know who's in that alliance unless I click on each individual empire and look at who they belong to. If I could just like hit a button, see the alliance map mode and see who's in what alliance so I can plan accordingly,
right,
that would be nice. Like little quality of life stuff. But bigger things like better trading, better espionage, that will come in time.
Yeah. Ryan, are you going to check it out, I guess?
Yes. Mm-hmm. It's, to be honest with you, it's one of those things where, like, I have 800 hours or more combined in those in CK2 and EU4.
Yeah.
So it's like the idea of playing an hour of Stellaris makes no sense to my brain. It's like, why would I ever do that? But a journey of 1,000 miles starts with a single step, right?
That's right.
So you
gotta get that deep enough.
I need to, and just need to check it out. Step one is probably using that code to download the game. And then I'll
step
check
one's
it
creating the universe, man. But like
step one, you
got this one
the
for real.
Then two, well, first you gotta have a data bank, which requires knowledge produced from an office bill. Anyway,
okay.
Yeah, I gotta check it out. People are asking me about it, and I feel bad just ignoring them. But there's a lot of Paradox stuff coming out. Like Hearts of Iron 4 comes out next month too. So I'm like, man, is there enough room in my life for two Paradox games at the same time? Yeah. The answer to that question is no. Because
for anyone ever,
there's room for one.
So we'll see which one ends up tickling my fancy like a little bit more, and then we'll move from that point onwards.
Yeah, I like the I'm just seeing it actually on your screen right now, Matt, as I'm watching your Let's Play videos. The I like the fleet formation as well. It's I think it's pretty commonplace to expect that the fleet and the combat would all work pretty fluidly, but the fact that it does, I think, is a nice selling point for it too. I like the management in general of units and inventory and all that is pretty well done.
Yep, it's great. Mm-hmm. I highly recommend it. There's tons of systems in play, and you can get as complicated as you want it to get, or you can maintain a relatively simple play style and still do fine.
Mm-hmm. All right. That's Stellaris. Available $40, full price right now on Steam. Just came out this week.
It's good. Only stuff. $40?
Yeah, only $40. You got a Nova Edition is $50. There's a Galaxy Edition, which is $70, and I guess there's... Well, I don't know actually what the difference is. Oh, here we go. You get the soundtrack and forum icon with the Nova Edition. So there you go. Oh, and exclusive Alien Race as well.
The soundtrack is excellent. Mm-hmm. I will say.
Oh, definitely. That was absolutely one of the first things I noticed just starting up the game. I love the aesthetic, but the soundtrack is phenomenal. It just like fits so well good with it. Mm-hmm. Okay, Stellaris. It's good stuff. Highly recommend it. And let's get into everybody's favorite segment. It's Ask Roundtable. Ask Roundtable. Every single week, you send your questions into roundtableyt@gmail.com. We do our best to answer them. This week's question comes from Benjamin, and he wants to know, do any of you have a game that you despise but is well-regarded by the majority of people? Nick is not allowed to answer Dark Souls 2. Despise is the word that we have to change right away, because we have to make this a safe environment, a judgment-free zone. We're not gonna throw anybody or any games under the bus here, right? But we want to say this is a safe
by
place.
By definition, we're throwing one under the bus.
We are, yes. It's unavoidable.
Preface it by, this is our personal opinion.
Yeah, yep.
And you may not agree with it.
We're going to get torched. Someone's going to get torched for something in this segment, but we want to try to preface it with as many warnings as we can. All right.
It's a game that is beloved that we despise or close to it.
Let's just
Does it
go
have to be
ahead
a single
and call
game
it,
or a series?
You can do a series too. Yeah, if you want to torch an entire series, I won't stop you.
Yeah. Okay, sure.
All right. Whoever wants to go first, I'm going to open the floor because I don't want to put anybody in the spotlight right away. Anybody want to do it? Anybody want to volunteer as tribute? No?
I know what Ryan's going to say.
Do you?
I think so.
I want to hear you say what you think Ryan's going to say.
Yeah.
I can't. It's that war game that everybody was like, it's so good because you're the bad guy.
Oh!
Oh, yeah. No, Spec Ops the Line, I'm guessing, is
Spec
what
Ops the Line.
Yep, you did
yep.
do my job for me, yeah. Spec Ops the Line is not nearly as smart as it thinks it is.
Okay.
Is my feeling on Spec Ops the Line. Mm-hmm. It's a bad, in my opinion, it's derivative third-person action game. And I don't know if this is what happened, but you can easily, in my head, this is what happened. Where they said, hey, our game's kind of shitty. What are we going to do about it? And then they're like, well, what if we broach the question that's been broached in thousands of other media, but not necessarily in games yet, where are you not the true monster of war? Are you not your own enemy? Mm-hmm. And then they were like, oh, shit. And then think piece after think piece is, oh, this game is it's full of pathos. It's just a... I get that. I understand intellectually the game, And it did have a little bit of like, oh, that's sort of interesting, but the game is not very good, in my opinion. I think that that game gets a lot of credit that it does not deserve.
I think you're right in that the game is just average at best. Like, as far as it being a third-person cover shooter, it's okay, right? But
yeah.
I liked it. I liked that it did something different, you know? I think it got up its own ass quite a bit as far as some of the messages went. But I think I liked playing it. I thought, like, I played through the whole thing. I beat it, which is, kind of a, well, okay, does that not say something by itself?
No, because it's like 5 hours long. Like, well, yeah. I bought it in the Steam sale when it was like a few months old and it was 50% off. And I was still like, yo, this is novel to get a new release at this price. So I'm like, I'm going to play this whole thing.
Yeah.
Like, I got that and that and Max Payne 3 at the same time. And for all the problems that a lot of people have with Max Payne 3, it's the same game as Spec Ops The Line, but mechanically and narratively, like, 10 times better. As soon as you get into the situation where people are like, yeah, the game is boring because they designed it that way so that the emotional part would hit harder, I'm like, no. No, they did not. Or if they did, they shouldn't have. Yeah. It compromises it to a point. If you're going to make that point, it doesn't need to be 5 hours long. Right. 5 hours of you know, like,
they had to justify the AAA price tag, though, right? Like, yeah, they couldn't come at it from the indie angle.
They don't have to do anything as far as
I'm concerned. They thought they did, though.
I'm not defending them. They did what they did, and I'm just analyzing it as a piece of media.
Sure.
I'm not saying that, you know, they're bad game developers. I'm just saying that the game itself, I think, is an okay game that has been elevated by a pretty superficial gimmick, in my opinion.
I'm just gonna go on record as saying that I was enlightened a little bit back in the day. That game, it gave me a little bit more perspective, man. So I don't want to just entirely throw him under the bus.
I can't even be mad at you, Bear, because you just don't watch movies.
That's right.
So, yeah, that's true.
I have zero cultural influence apart from the games I play. Right. So
that may
I
have
need
been
that.
Like the 20th piece of media you ever consumed. So. In no way can I be like,
I watched Saving Private Ryan because my mom insisted that I have some perspective on the difficulties of war, so I've got at least that little bit of knowledge about it.
There's some tropes that telegraph so often in movies, though, and I think the big point of why this was relevant or poignant for so many people was it was somebody going, hey, let's apply that trope to a video game now.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's kind of one of those things where, like, you've been shooting... Like, I mean, I don't want to say it, you're shooting brown people in the face for like 2 hours.
Yeah.
And then one of your guys is like, maybe we're like kind of agents of evil. And you're like, yeah.
Wow.
Obviously.
Holy shit. We're like, self-aware now.
Even if you're fighting the most evil person in the world, there's got to be some pathos where you shoot somebody and they die and you go, oh, that made me feel something. Like, that made me feel bad. And, like, let me examine this on a personal level. 2 hours of just blowing people away. And then you're like, I don't know if I can do this anymore. You're like, what? You killed, like, 400 people. You can't. It's just so tonally dissonant.
All right. We'll let you off the hook here. Someone else has got to go. I'm not going to take the reins. Mathis or Nick? You gotta submit.
I want somebody to guess what you think mine is. All right. I like that you guys
Dark
guessed.
Dark Souls 2.
Sure, yeah, no, that sounds good, actually.
I'm not allowed to pick that one.
So it's not Dark Souls 2, then. So, like, a game that Nick hated that was beloved. Man.
I'm doing a series. So pick a major series.
This is, like, it's the prelude to Nick's weird games here.
It's a triple A series, too. It's very well known. There's Assassin's a chance you Creed. Can figure it out. That's too easy, but
like
good
newer?
Call.
Tried.
It's long-reaching, Barry.
Give me the first letter.
All over.
Call of Duty.
Yeah, I was just going to say Call of Duty as soon as you said that.
Also
too
easy, but also
I think that Nick likes the Metal Gear Solid franchise.
Oh, shit.
Is it going to be Metal Gear Solid 5?
No.
Oh.
I think...
I like where he's going. Keep going.
Uh-oh.
I think that Nick likes...
Are you just looking at, like...
I think he likes Grand Theft Auto.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely, I like that.
Mm-hmm. with your bike rides.
I think he's okay with some RPGs. I think Nick's okay with Final Fantasy and The Witcher. You know, and
Nick,
Dragon
Nick,
Age.
What don't you like?
Hitman.
Oh. Yeah, I feel like Ryan's about to like just nail it.
Just land on it. Yeah.
I feel like I'm so close. When did the last game in this series come out?
Last year.
So 2015.
Yeah, that's right.
Let the cog spin here for another minute or so. Hold on. You can get it.
Give it a minute.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. 2015. Just making sure. Years fly by.
Did we all play it? Did we talk about it on the podcast?
Yes. Oh, yeah, we did.
There's so many. I don't remember you ever, like... Well, no, I do remember you vehemently disliking a couple of things, but I don't think... Well, hmm.
And you hate the franchise.
I think we've gotten to the point where I gotta know.
Yeah, I gotta know.
What is it?
All right, so the caveat here is the one that you're all trying to figure out which one I'm talking about. That game I didn't despise... And also, Revengeance. It's Metal Gear. I don't get Metal Gear.
Yeah, all right.
I don't get Metal Gear. Since the beginning, I've played it on the NES. I've played almost every single iteration except for Metal Gear Solid 3, which I'm told is the best one.
The best,
which is,
yeah.
Okay, my bad, I guess. and I've always tried to give them a fair chance to prove their case to me. I've played usually between 3 and 8 hours into each one of them. And they always just end up going off the rail to the extent that I just don't care about the story because it gets so batshit insane. I like the idea of it, and I like the character of Solid Snake, and the rest of it just doesn't come together for me for some reason. And I want to like it, and I like Revengeance because it's crazy and it embraces how crazy it is in a way that is somehow separate from that world where it tries to be serious and crazy at the same time. This one doesn't try to be serious. It's just stupid crazy. And I like that.
I'm with you on the story. Like, Metal Gear story is Kingdom Hearts level of convoluted.
Metal Gear, yeah, that's actually a great comparison. Metal Gear is like the military version of Kingdom Hearts.
Yeah, it's ridiculous.
It's like Tom Clancy fan fiction.
Yeah.
Like, basically.
A weeaboo took Tom Clancy's games and was like, I'm gonna fucking write a sweet fan
and these two are gonna bang, and these two are gonna bang.
Well, so King Chavez is on fire, and
with 5, I thought they were starting up for Revengeance Part 2 with Solid Snake, and I was like, fuck yeah, this is the one, I'm in.
Mm-hmm.
I play through the intro, we get like maybe 4 hours in, and it's like, nope, it's back to Metal Gear again.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, MGS 5 opened up with like a flaming whale in the sky.
The intro was amazing, I love the intro.
Metal Gear Solid games are always like, I don't even know what's going on. Nanomachines and clones and Snake's dead, but not dead, but old, but he's not dead.
Look, it's all good. If you love it out there, enjoy it. I'm just saying, I don't think I can get into it. I'm going to keep trying them one day.
But like Revengeance you liked, right? Like,
yeah, Revengeance is cool.
And it sounds like that is like the Metal Gear game designed for you, where instead of trying to play it off like there's this cryptic nature to all the crazy insanity going on, it's just like, hey, we're fucking weird and wild. Let's go.
Take some time and cut apart some watermelons if you want. I don't care.
Yeah.
Have fun.
I remember that tech demo.
Oh, yeah.
It was awesome.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, similarly, man. Before anybody else goes on,
Revengeance. Spec Ops.
Yeah, Spec Ops. But also, Revengeance is now beloved, and I thought it was just okay. It's different strokes for different folks, but like, and now it's people are like, "Oh, dude, talking about classics, you got to bring up Revengeance." And at the time, I played through and I beat it, and I was like, "Man, it's just all right." I thought DMC was better.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think the bar might be a little low at the moment because we haven't had a lot of really fantastic ones recently. Character action games, I mean.
That's very true. Just Bayonetta and then DMC and this.
Are people still like circle jerk and shit all over DMC? Because I thought DMC was great as well.
I haven't really been hearing a lot about DMC like at all recently.
Well, no, it's in hibernation right now. We'll see it come back. But I mean, like the reboot DMC, people hated it.
Yeah.
But I thought
people had to end up eating their own feet on that one. Is that an expression?
Sure.
But
yeah, it is.
Why not? Put it in their mouth. That's it. Because DMC is a great game, but superficially the character design, people were like, oh, you know, he's like emo now. And he is pretty shitty, but the game is really good.
Gameplay is great.
I felt people it was just, quite heavy-handed. Like, the story, they tried to approach some themes that were just, like, really not necessary to get into for a Devil May Cry game. In my opinion, the gameplay was fine, but it kind of ultimately distilled down to, like, there's these two polarities, and how do you play with those two polarities? And you kind of run through all the permutations pretty quickly. So once you've done that, it feels like you've kind of seen everything the game has to offer, and it's also kind of short. But, you know, it had some cool spectacle moments, I suppose, as well, so it kind of balanced out. Mm-hmm. Wasn't my favorite of the series, but I didn't think it was bad, just kind of average.
All right, well, because you were willing to go out on a limb there with the Metal Gear franchise, I think I'm going to go ahead and say what I'm going to say here. And
Kingdom Hearts.
It's not Kingdom Hearts. I actually love Kingdom Hearts. And I think, like, if we were to flip this question around, do you have a game that people your age probably shouldn't love as much as they do, but you do anyway, despite the social pressure not to? I love
Sonic
Kingdom
the Hedgehog
Hearts,
06.
I love Kingdom Hearts. I think
brave.
Kingdom Hearts is great. I just really don't like Zelda games that much. I just don't. So, and I've tried. I've tried my heart out.
Talk us through the story progression for you. Where did it start and
sure.
how did you get to where you are now?
Absolutely. So I think it has to start with the fact that I was a Sega kid growing up. A Sega kid transitioned into a PlayStation kid. So I had the Sonic the Hedgehogs. I had the Crash Bandicoots. Those were my go-to mascots back in my childhood. Also, Crash Team Racing is probably like the greatest kart racer of all time. I gotta submit that
it's
as
great
well.
Game. Yeah.
But then I got an N64 at some point. In fact, I got funnily enough, I bought an N64 in college, and I got Ocarina of Time on that. So that was the first time I played Ocarina of Time. And I think I think it's pretty obvious that if I had played Ocarina of Time when it was first released, I would have a much better experience with it, right? I think it's probably not stood the test of time as far as its playability is concerned in the modern age. So being as old as I was for my first Ocarina of Time experience probably soiled it a little bit. But I still really just was not captivated by it that much. I bought Wind Waker HD on my Wii U, tried it. I've played probably 3 or 4 hours of it now, and everyone says, actually, I think Wind Waker HD sort of has like a Kingdom Hearts 2 caveat to it, where everybody in that game is like, okay, you gotta play through like the 3-hour intro to Kingdom Hearts 2, but then after that, it's great, right? Like, you just gotta endure the first few hours, which is not something I think that could be said anymore to anyone. It's
we
like,
gotta talk about Kingdom Hearts one time on the show, because I need you to talk me through how Kingdom Hearts 2 is good. Sorry, keep
okay,
going.
Okay, no, yeah, we will do that. But yeah, like for Wind Waker HD, I guess there's sort of that same caveat, as I mentioned, where like, okay, so you've got to get through the first bit where you're being introduced to everybody and there's like the island that you're limited to. But once you get out into the real world and you're exploring and you're on the ship and stuff, then it's great. And I'm trying to push through that, but it's not my style of game, I guess. You know, like it feels a lot of the time like it's a game primarily aimed at kids. Not just because of, you know, like the art style and the fact that it is a game marketed heavily at kids, but also just because a lot of the gameplay is really hand-holdy, it's on rails, it doesn't feel like I'm accomplishing anything, it just feels like I'm checking off items.
Wait,
on
what's
a list.
On rails?
The Wind Waker HD, like, it feels like, well, it's not, okay, it's not on rails, that's a bad way to describe it.
Okay, it's the most not on rails.
Yeah,
that's
mislabeled. I should say it's like, okay. It feels like it's trying too hard to show me what I have to do. Does that make more sense? Like it doesn't give me any credit as a player. Is
not respecting your time or knowledge or intelligence.
Exactly.
Yes.
Yeah, and I think that's one of the biggest issues for me with especially with Wind Waker for what I've played of it, and for Zelda in general, just seems like it is sort of designed at the player who does not necessarily have as much proficiency in games in general. So
I don't know about that.
Look, I might be wrong.
I'm totally okay with being wrong on it.
Yeah,
I will still have problems in water temples.
Yeah,
because I'm just bad.
Yeah,
I'm with you though, Bear, in that Zelda is not really a game I enjoy anymore. And I was thinking about, like, your reasons. I think they're similar to my reasons in that I grew up with Zelda. Zelda was fantastic when I was a kid because it was doing what other games weren't doing. But as I got older, Zelda didn't really get older with me. And I found fantasy.
Zelda got younger.
Yeah.
Yeah. I found fantasy open world games that did what I wanted, but better. And Zelda just never progressed. And I just kind of fell. I think the last, I played through the last Zelda I played through completely was Twilight Princess when it first came out. Mm-hmm. And it took me a long time because I got bored of it. So I'm with you there.
Yeah.
Honestly, I like that you used that. I think you did a good thing by bringing that up. I think there's some good stuff to talk about
and
there.
I want to actually, like, please, if people that know me well enough to maybe have an idea of what kind of Zelda game I might like, I'd be more than welcome to try that out. I'd love to like Zelda, but so far just hasn't really been my cup of tea, I guess.
It's hard.
I should say, since I've been characterized as the dude that wants to kill Zelda now, I actually am a pretty big Zelda fan for the most part.
That's from like 2 weeks ago only, right?
Yeah. Most of them I quite liked. But I also could find flaws in pretty much all of them, some of which are very large flaws. Mm-hmm. And then you start to look at the whole galaxy of Zelda, as it were, and it feels like there's a lot more holes than maybe there should be at this point, and that it might be headed in a downward trajectory, in my opinion.
I think of Zelda the same way I think of, like, the Marvel Cinematic Universe, where once every year, you know, in Zelda's case, I guess it's like once every 3 or 4 years, there's a new Zelda game, and I know what I'm getting into. I know Iron Man's gonna punch a dude in the face, and Jarvis is gonna make some wisecracks, and he's really gonna die because they're far too important to the cinematic universe. Mm-hmm. But I really liked, although I did not finish, I really liked A Link Between Worlds, and I also played through all of Twilight Princess. After playing through all of Twilight Princess, I went back and played through all of A Link to the Past, and I mean, it's not a, like, oh, unpopular opinion, I like Zelda, but I don't know. I kind of like that Zelda hasn't grown up in the sense that I have no interest in, like, an open-world Zelda game or not to be derisive, but an edgy Zelda game. Like, I like going back to that world. Mm-hmm. And that, like, you know, there's going to be 3 little dungeons. You're going to get to, like, the midpoint of the game. And there's going to be 7 dungeons, and then you're going to fight Ganon at the end. Like, that is like totally fine now by me to just to stick with that formula.
The idea over and over. The idea of an edgy Zelda game actually made me think of Hyrule Warriors as well, which, you know, isn't exactly even a Zelda game, but is...
Or edgy.
Yeah, or edgy.
Twilight Princess is the edgy one.
I guess
clearly.
So, right?
We actually had this conversation... I think we talked about Zelda last week, and I talked about Zelda on the co-optional last week, and TB brought up a good point. Do you think the natural progression for Zelda players who are our age is Dark Souls?
Yes.
Oh.
Dark Souls is that edgy Zelda. Where
you ever mentioned that on this podcast? Oh, I talked with Rob about this for hours.
Really?
Oh, goddamn it.
Oh, he brought it up, and he was like, do you think Dark Souls is like the next step? Like, for like edgy adult Zelda type games?
It lacks puzzling 100%, though.
Yeah, it definitely lacks puzzles. I'll give you that. Yeah. But
it's
like
got the wonder and the mystery, and it's got the darkness that we look for that was always being attempted in what they thought was going to be the future for Zelda, which is the Twilight Princess direction. And then they kept kind of backpedaling and made it more cartoony.
That actually, weirdly enough, then, that sort of makes my point again, in that I didn't necessarily even like Dark Souls 2 that much. I mean, like, I played Dark Souls 1 in its entirety, obviously, and I enjoyed that well enough, but I think I enjoyed it mostly because of the experience, and I didn't even necessarily like playing it that much. So maybe I just don't like those sorts of games in general, you know? It's like, maybe just the sort of style of game that is just doesn't appeal to me as much. Could very well be the case. Yeah. All right, well, that's mine. Mathis. I think you're last up, right?
Yeah, mine's, you've heard me say it before. One that got, I guess, received well, I just didn't enjoy that much, Fallout 4. Mm. Bethesda Fallouts in general, like, I liked Fallout 3, but then, you know, Obsidian came and did Fallout New Vegas, and I thought it was better. Now Fallout 4, I understand it's a good game in some respects, the shooter aspect, and, like, the world that Bethesda built is really fun to explore, but the aspects I'm looking for in a Fallout game are non-existent for the most part. Branching storylines, fun side quests with depth to them, that stuff just didn't exist in Fallout 4, and the stuff that they added, like the crafting system, was neat, but I could have given two shits about it.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, I put my 1 week of, like, where I did the Fallout 4 stream for a week, and then I never touched it again because it just wasn't what I was looking for.
You know,
unfortunately,
with Fallout 4, I think it was like the more I played of it, the less I enjoyed it, because I think everybody got to the point where they were like, okay, I'm pretty tired of just collecting literally everything I see in order to actually make some progress on my settlements, even though you could just ignore that if you wanted to as well. But, you know, it's just a little bit of oversaturation of the sort of same style of missions I found a lot of the time.
It's the other thing that I hate about Fallout 4 is that we waited so long for the next Fallout. People have been clamoring for it forever. And they've said they've been working on it since Skyrim finished or something. And when it comes out, it's just another Bethesda game. It's on the same engine. Yeah. There's nothing like exciting or new about it. It's the classic, like, as wide as an ocean, as deep as a puddle. You know, like, it's a fucking Bethesda game. And you expect, like, with Fallout especially, or just even Elder Scrolls, like, the next installation is going to be as revolutionary, or at least push the genre forward a little bit in a particular direction, when really all it is just another Bethesda game on the same engine with weird fucking bugs and physics that don't really look natural.
Yeah, and, falling through the map, all that shit.
Yeah, and then the shitty level of Bethesda writing and storytelling that is prevalent through all of their games. And on top of it just being a subpar Fallout game, that on top of it, it destroyed it for me. Fallout 4 is
We're going to sound like the biggest hypocrites here if we're all going around the table thinking, like, yeah, Fallout 4 wasn't that good after, like, 3 months ago. We're all just singing its praises.
Ryan likes it.
I think Fallout 4 is a good to great game, but for the wrong reasons.
Okay.
Like, this would be like if they made a Dark Souls 4 and, like, every time you fought a boss, the boss was like, well, hello, I am Guinevere of the Deep, and I have consumed the soul of this boss, and I will take over the world. And you're like, you know. But what's, and then the combat names was, like, shit. They'd be like, well, the story is, like, I guess robust and, like, well told, but I didn't want that. I wanted more of, like, this. I wanted the awesome, nuanced combat and then the mysterious lore. And Fallout 4 is like, well, the guns shoot amazingly, but, you know, the RPG elements, we've toned those back. Like, it's an okay, if this was like an IP, you'd be like, it's kind of cool. Like, this is a game that has promise, or a series that has promise. But as a Fallout game, I agree that it probably, in hindsight, has failed the audience from New Vegas and 3.
Yeah.
I think it's also kind of a sliding scale that Mathis is seeing it through, because he probably loves Fallout way more than a lot of people would consider that they do. So being disappointing counts for more to him than it might to others, which I respect that opinion. I kind of feel somewhat the same way in that I think it could have been better, but I also enjoyed it, if that makes sense.
Indeed. Cool.
Yep, that's me.
Yeah, all right.
The thing that sucks about Fallout 4 is that they can't save it. Like, no,
it's too late.
They can't save it with DLC that'll turn it into the Fallout game that people want. Which, unlike something
like Stellaris. They have something on the way, too, don't they? It's like Far Harbor or something like that for Fallout 4.
Yeah, they have, like, they have some story stuff on the way. And they've added, like, the workshop. Wasteland workshop. Yeah, you can make, like, your own automatons, basically, which is really cool. But, like, until they fix the dialogue, it's like,
it's too late.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, the thing I can hope for is, like, they're going to do what they did last time and be like, all right, here's the tools, Obsidian, make your Fallout game. And I wonder if, we've talked about this 100 times, but I wonder if a lot of the dialogue problem is because they were like, we're going to fully voice everything.
Yeah.
I want this to be Witcher the straw that broke the camel's back and just be like, hey, look, they're not going to take us using the same engine again. Like, they just will not it now.
That's sort of what I'm hoping happened to Far Cry Primal, too, is that, you know, like, let's go ahead and change things up a little bit more here. Yeah. All right. That is all the games we despise. There we go. Thank you very much, Benjamin. Yeah.
We tried to do it.
Yeah, we did our best.
Generally and safely.
Actually, there are a couple of games I'm surprised didn't get brought up. I'm surprised that the new Tomb Raider didn't get brought up. Because although I loved the sequel, I can totally understand why people would be like, man, it's like playing a movie. I think there's a huge contingent of people out there that think that those games are shit and are basically, quote-unquote, glorified movies.
Oh, I haven't really heard that. I loved Rise of the Tomb Raider. I thought it was great.
No, I see where you're coming from. I think probably Uncharted would be more likely the target lately, though.
I guess it's a little more recent, yeah.
Even more cinematic than I think Tomb Raider tries to be.
Yeah, I can see that. Well, yeah, I can see both now,
we'll
I guess.
We'll talk about Uncharted next week.
Mm-hmm. All right. Thank you very much, Benjamin. That was a great Ask Roundtable question. Appreciate that. And if you want to send in an Ask Roundtable question, you can do so. RoundtableYT@gmail.com is where you want to send that. Time for everybody's favorite segment after our favorite segment of the Queer Games.
Yeah, next
Weird Game. What's up?
I'm ready.
All right. There we go. Nick's Weird Games. Every single week, Nick is going to go get a weird game from his catalog of very many Nick's Weird Games. We're going to try to guess it based on hints. You can play along in chat as well if you'd like. And we also do a little fun, goofy theme song sing-along. So this time, how about in honor of the closure of Disney Infinity and Avalanche Studios, we go with a classic Disney tune.
I feel like I've already done A Whole New World.
But Let It Go by Frozen.
Let It Go, the Frozen
Let It Go by Frozen. I really...
By Frozen,
yeah. I really don't know... I've heard it enough, but I don't know the lyrics except for the chorus.
Oh, you can start with the chorus. I'm okay with that.
All right, Nick, go. Yeah, I'm going to hijack while you start.
I don't have to go. The game's right here. Just have fun.
It's games. It's for PlayStation 2. Nick's Weird Games. Nick's Weird Games. Yeah. It's from 2002. I don't know what's this fucking game from his shitty bookshelf. I've never played any Nick's Weird Games. Something like that.
That was pretty great at the end.
I don't know, man.
I'm going to go pick up a Frozen amiibo today now.
Yeah.
Disney Infinity figure, whatever, same thing.
Right.
Well, he's right about one thing. It is a game for PlayStation 2, so let's start off there.
Sweet.
All right,
hang on, hi, chat.
Did it come out in 2002?
Hide your chat.
All right, we're good.
Close. Came out in 2001.
Okay.
Whoa.
Shadow of the
Colossus. The Bouncer, Square.
The Bouncer and Shadow of the Colossus. No, neither.
Damn.
Shadow of the Bouncer.
This is developed and published by Namco.
All right.
Okay.
2001.
Okay.
Nanobrain thing.
There was a port that was planned for the Nintendo GameCube, but was canceled for unknown reasons.
Ooh, okay. Unknown reasons.
That's another great name for a Nick's Weird game. Unknown reasons.
That's a good
I haven't bought that yet.
Takes place in 1930 Chicago. You're a beat detective who encounters a supernatural mystery in the loop.
I've played that on DS a few times.
It's been happening a lot.
It's a platformer. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
You play as a sort of an animal character.
Oh.
With an enchant. I know, weird, right? Imagine that. There's an enchanted world to unveil, and the game features gameplay that is inspired by the classics of 2D side-scrolling with 3D rendered environments. There's classic platforming stages with boss battles and board riding stages.
Board riding.
What's your guess?
Math is yours. Is it
a 2D platformer? Is it a 2D platformer?
It's a 2D side scroller with 3D.
God, I feel like I'm picturing in my head. Odyssey. No. I think I know what you have. I can't think of the name of the game.
Is it Jersey Devil?
No.
Is it Hexen?
Definitely Hexen. Is it like
I wish I had actually like a major
color? This is gonna be a really weird question, but is purple like a major color involved in the game? No.
Jersey Devil is purple.
Has anybody in chat gotten it yet, Nick?
I'm not looking at chat yet. I'm still focusing on not saying the name of it by accident. that requires a lot of attention.
It does,
for me,
a lot of cognitive awareness.
Is it Sly Cooper and the Thievius Raccoonus?
No, but that's a good guess.
There's a lot of purple in that game too.
In the standard stages, the goal is to reach the end of the level by means of using enemies to overcome obstacles and solve puzzles. So there are puzzles involved in this.
Mm.
You get a limited amount of health in the form of hearts, which are reduced when coming into contact with enemies and certain obstacles.
Whoa!
Can you imagine a world where that could happen?
Back in 2001, remember when that was revolutionary? Holy shit.
They would write that on the back of the box easily.
All right.
Is it a sequel to a game?
It is.
Was the first game on the PS1?
Oh my god.
Okay, that's enough questions.
I don't know.
Maybe I'll read a little bit off the back now that I've exhausted a lot of the wiki. Okay. Character has long ears.
Is it a Lombax?
It's not a Lombax.
Oh.
Is it a Rayman game?
It's not a Rayman game. You can explore dozens of fascinating areas.
It never tells us anything.
I know.
Dozens of fascinating areas, 8 wonderful game modes. Anything.
8 awesome angles. All new animation techniques and timeless gameplay. That's actually probably true. What's the original called? Includes board riding, dynamic perceptual changes, and treacherous.
Yeah, the board riding I feel should probably be a giveaway, but I'm not picking up on it.
What is board riding? I don't understand what board riding is.
What are you talking about?
Is it Jet Set Radio or something?
No.
Jet
Set Radio didn't come out on PS2.
Did it not? Oh.
Came out on Xbox.
Jet Force Gemini?
Yeah, that.
Ace Combat?
Came out on Dreamcast, and then they made the sequel on Xbox, is what I'm trying to say.
All right, I think I'm at a loss.
What about the word, this is the last hint I'm giving, you don't get it from this, then you're done. Lunaty.
Lunaty? That sounds so fucking familiar.
You're out. All right, good try, guys. Today's game was Kelowna 2, Lunaty's...
Ah, fuck yes, all right.
Oh, I remember that thing, yeah.
Sorry, Klonoa. I always say it wrong, it's Klonoa.
Klonoa, I remember seeing that, yeah, on like the Blockbuster shelves.
Yo, that's fucking Sonic.
It looks quite
that
like Sonic.
That is Sonic, yeah.
That is Sonic.
Look at the eyes. Oh, that's just...
He's holding a ring, too.
Oh, my God, he is. With a Chaos Emerald in it. Oh, my God.
Namco's Sonic.
Oh, shit. Oh, that was Ask Roundtable topic the whole time. What's wrong with me? I'm the worst podcast host ever.
See got it in chat right here.
New theme is Nick. Klonoa 2.
Oh. A lot of people said Klonoa, which I can't really fault them for because they didn't know it was going to be the sequel. Mm-hmm. But Flash Fox nailed the actual
title. Would you have given it to
title.
Us if we said Klonoa instead of Klonoa 2?
I couldn't. I would have said it was the sequel, and you would have had to tell me what the full title was.
Oh, man.
Klonoa 2, Lunatia's Veil?
Maybe I got
to
It's anyway, Flash Fox 65. I'm going to recognize you as our winner for
right
today.
On.
It's
awesome.
The direct sequel to 1997's Klonoa, Door to Phantom Isle.
All right. Goodness.
It's a weird game. I did it.
You did it. Well done, Nick. Thank you for stumping us again.
The soundtrack was composed by 8 individuals. A 2-disc 73-track set was released exclusively in Japan.
Whoa.
What in the world? It was you got a couple hours to kill? I've been meaning to chew my way through the Klonoa 2 Lunatia's Veil soundtrack released only in Japan.
Why don't you come on over? We'll have import brews. All right. Here we go. Thank you guys very much for watching, for joining us for Roundtable Live this week. Hope you enjoyed the show. And thank you very much for rating the show 5 stars on iTunes as well. We appreciate that. You can also go over to roundtablepodcast.reddit.com or reddit.com/r/roundtablepodcast for the purists among you in the subreddit lexicon. You can also follow us over on Twitter, Roundtable PC is where we are there. You can catch the VOD if you miss any part of today's show, either here on Twitch or over on any of our YouTube channels. You can get it there, as well as iTunes and SoundCloud for the audio-only versions. And we also want to thank our patrons for this episode over on patreon.com/roundtable. Thank you guys very much for continuing to support the show over there. I want to give a special nod to those who are pledging at the $20 tier and above, which include Julian Abelsgaard, Scrody119, Christopher Flagg, Oren Saltzman, Greenlight, Mavier, Jonathan Graham, Matt, Alexander Spillman, General Crunk, Ignacio0891, Brizzlebrit, Positron, Justin, Logan Ray, Samurfet, Supermonoman, Mediocrities, Eric Schooley, and Myth Scarab. Thank you guys so much for your continued support over on Patreon. Really appreciate that. Also, of course, all the little $1 and $5, $2 pledges. Also, want to give a big shout out to everybody that's been doing those continually as well. Super helpful. Thank you very much for supporting the show over on Patreon. And thank you very much for joining us for today's episode of Roundtable Live. And we'll see you next time, everybody. Goodbye.
Peace. See you later.
Bye.